Speaker, sir, I thank you for this opportunity that you have given me to speak in support of the President's address. Sir, as I stand here, I am overwhelmed with the feeling of gratitude that my Prime Minister gave me an opportunity to come to this temple of democracy and sit here and speak here in this hallowed halls where the great Sardar Patels, the Baba Saheb Ambedkars, the K.M. Munshis, the Chakravarti Rajgopalacharis, and the Atal Bihari Vajpayees stood, spoke, and crafted the country's present, future, and history. Sir, the very fact that a 28-year-old young man hailing from a middle-class family can even dream of coming into an institution as great as this just shows how the Bharatiya Janata Party, under the leadership of the great Prime Minister Narendra Modi, has radically transformed the country's electorate, the country's polity, in such a manner that our country's democracy is only becoming strengthened every single day. So I remember in 2014, as a volunteer of the Prime Minister, in Bangalore and other parts of the state, I was distributing pamphlets, writing slogans, and making speeches in small gatherings in support of the Prime Minister. I never even dreamed that in 5 years I will have the opportunity to be speaking in this great institution, because for a very long time politics was more of family businesses, and the country's political institutions and the country's political geography more or less seemed to be under the control of a few oligarchs. And more and more we seem like kleptocracy. And today, sir, if a chai wala has risen to the post of the country's Prime Minister, not for once but for two times, it only shows that the country's democracy is being strengthened, and along with him, he is bringing people like us as faces of New India, as faces of Young India, to come and speak on our country's aspirations. Sir, this victory, which is historic in so many counts, is a result of not only the Bharatiya Janata Party's workers, but the common Indian fought this election. The Prime Minister in many a times has spoken that this election was an election where the common Indian fought. He fought this election because he wanted to see a better India. In his mind and in his heart, he had hopes that his tomorrow will be better than what his yesterday was. Sir, from the auto rickshaw driver who plastered Namo Again stickers on his auto rickshaw, to the IT savvy guy in Bangalore who wore a t-shirt of Namo Again, to those NRIs sitting in different time zones but waking up and tweeting their support for the Prime Minister, the common Indian felt that the victory of the Prime Minister is victory of a new India, which is why they all came together. So we speak of different quotients in this country. We speak about the intelligence quotient of a person. We speak about the emotional quotient of a person. So I think from 2014 to 2019, one of the greatest transformations that have taken place in the country is that the country's political quotient of the country's electorate has tremendously increased. And we are much more an enlightened society. We are a great more enlightened and mature democracy. And the result of that is the opposition's fake news, the opposition's lies, the opposition's propaganda fell flat Because the young people of today, they do not believe in the narrative that is crafted by a handful of editors or anybody sitting in the Luckians Club here in Delhi, but they write, speak and edit what they want to do on their own, because today social media has given a democratic platform where I can speak what I want unhindered by the fact that a few people with prejudices stop me. And this is also contributed to the rise in the country's political narrative back among the young Indians. So, from 2014 to 2019, we have achieved a lot of things. Some of the greatest transformations took place. As a young Indian, sir, who was reading in our social sciences textbook that we are a developing country from the last 60 years, a sense of frustration, a sense of anger, when other countries, much smaller in size than ours, much less in population than ours, if they were galloping fast and developing, why was it that our country was not progressing in the same pace? If Indians could prosper outside of India, if they could do well for themselves and for their families and the countries, say in US, in the UK, in other parts of the country, why was it that Indians were not performing well in India? These questions troubled all of us. But sir, from 2014 to 2019, howsoever much the opposition may oppose us, and the foundation for building a new India started. An India, sir, which respects performance over pedigree. An India which votes and elects its leaders on the basis of what they deliver and not on the basis of what surnames they have next to their names. A new India rose, sir, in 2014, where the country's economy got such major changes, structural reforms. So much so that honesty, transparency, integrity in our professional lives was respected, was encouraged, and the country's economy, through the effects of demonetization, through the effect of the GST, through the effect of the IBC, I must fondly, with great reverence, sir, remember with gratitude the way Arun Jaitley ji has piloted and pivoted the GST, such a complicated constitutional and financial structure. The country will be everly indebted to him. And today, sir, India's economy is more formal, it is more organized, and it is more transparent and clean. Not just that, sir. In the last 5 years, the kind of achievements we made, whether it was in foreign policy, in international relations, in building ties with other countries, whether it was in the field of ensuring that the most necessary public services reach the last man in the line. Truly, sir, this country saw that the Indian government, if it wants to touch the common man, can actually touch the common man's lives. So, Baba Saheb Ambedkar had once prophetically said, on the 25th of November 1949, while introducing the constitution of this country in this very hallowed house, he was asked, what do you think of the constitution? Do you think it's a good constitution or is it a bad constitution? And this is what the great Baba Saheb said. He said, and I quote, "I feel, however good the constitution may be, it is sure to turn out bad because the people who are called to work on it happen to be a bad lot. However bad a constitution may be, it may turn out to be good if those who are called to work it happen to be a good lot." Sir, nothing changed from 2014 and 2019. The very same constitution, the very same laws, the very same officers, the very same workarounds, the very same loopholes in the organization. But what changed was the leader changed, sir. A good leader became the prime minister, and therefore the country's fortunes have changed. Sir, for a very long time, our economy was in shambles. 10 years under the UPA was a decade of decay, a decade of lost opportunities. A decade where young India felt the world was zipping past them, but we just stood like mute spectators. But sir, we have made a massive turnaround in the last 5 years. a turnaround that inspires all of us to put in one extra hour of work, because our Prime Minister tirelessly works 20 hours a day, and if we as young Indians cannot do it, he just inspires us, sir. And sir, for a very long time, the Latvian economists of this country very derisively labeled the 2.5 or 3% economic growth that the country achieved under Jawaharlal Nehru as the Hindu rate of growth. So I beg to disagree, because what we saw then was a myopic, confused economic policies in action. But what we are witnessing today, where India under the Prime Minister Narendra Modi's leadership is galloping as the world's fastest economy, today we are witnessing the real Hindu rate of growth in this country. Sir, the other most important thing that we witnessed in the last 5 years was that a culturally repressed country who could not wear its identity up its sleeve and proudly say that we belong to a civilization as great as ours, who, when a young Indian in school was made to cringe and feel apologetic that he belonged to a great Hindu faith, that has changed in the last 5 years, sir. And that, I think, is one of the irreversible changes which is beyond the confines of Indian polity. Today, sir, what the great Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji had given a poetic expression, Hindu tan man Hindu jeevan rag rag Hindu mera parichai, that has found socio-political expression under the Prime Ministership of Narendra Modi. Whether it is the Kumbh Mel, which attracts millions and millions of people from around the world, or whether it is the Prime Minister proudly doing the Ganga Arati on the banks of the Varanasi, or the meditation in Kedarnath, or it is the Yoga Day that is celebrated by hundreds of countries, including Islamic countries in the world, we feel proud that we belong to a Hindu civilization as great as ours. Sir, the people of this country gave us a very big mandate in 2014. They gave a big mandate to the Prime Minister because they wanted him to do bold things. And in 2019, they have given us a bigger mandate because they want us to do bolder things in 2019. And 2019, sir, will witness, the next 5 years will witness the rise of a new India. Sir, in summation, I want to say, what will this new India look like? Sir, the Rashtrapati's Honorable Rashtrapati's address outlines how a new India will look like. A new India, sir, would mean that each common Indian, the poor man on the street, the last proverbial man, the proverbial last man in the line, he will feel that he is a part of the national mainstream, that no one is left out. Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas is not merely a slogan. The common Indian woman in the village also got the Ujwala Yojana to her doorstep, as did the young startup in Bangalore receive his startup funding. Every single person was touched by the Modi government. And this will continue in an unprecedented fashion in the next 5 years. So, in the president's motion, a great stress has been laid on education. As a young Indian, sir, I must thank the Narendra Modi government for having come up with a spectacular education policy. The National Education Policy Draft 2019, which is out for discussion and debate, in my personal opinion, sir, will promise a root and branch reform of the Indian education system. A young Indian today takes loans to the tunes of lakhs of rupees, sir, mortgaging his family property because he wants to, I'll conclude in a few minutes, just 2-3 minutes, sir. He mortgages his family's property because he wants to go and study, because India's infrastructure, education infrastructure is dysfunctional. Sir, other thing that really gives me a lot of hope is that for the first time, our country's Prime Minister and the government is speaking the language of young India. It is speaking of starting 50,000 startups, and someone coming from Bangalore, sir, which is the startup capital of India, I must congratulate the Prime Minister for taking this initiative for 50,000 startups. Sir, startups means disruption. Startups means new ideas. Sir, startups are the new India space. Along with Birlas, the Godrejes, the Ambanis, the Tatas of yesterday, new India's, Oyo's, the Swiggy's, the Zomato's, the Flipkart's, the Culprits, all of them will join them, sir. This is the rise of a new India, sir. Sir, lastly, sir, there's just one thing that I would want to bring to your notice, sir. Sir, I have heard the opposition. And in all humility in my command, I must say, sir, I don't think they have learned their lessons. Yesterday, I heard the opposition leader here, the floor leader of the Lok Sabha from the Congress party, calling my prime minister, calling this country's prime minister in the most foul and unparliamentary language. During the whole of the campaign, the prime minister was subject to such and more grave personal attacks, sir, and the people of the country taught the opposition a lesson. And I must warn all of them, if they have still not learnt their lessons in the next Lok Sabha, starting from this seat to that seat, the whole of the 543 will be Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Bharatiya Janata Party MPs. The kind of arrogance, the kind of a sense of entitlement. Sir, even now, they are blaming the EVMs. What baffles me, sir, is after the elections, every single VVPAT was counter-checked with the electoral ballot. And I must say that I am proud to be an Indian because the election commission in this country conducts elections in a free and fair manner, which is an example for the rest of the world to follow. Not a single VVPAT mismatch, sir, not a single VVPAT. But sir, this still continue. Sir, just one more minute, sir. I will start concluding.
First time he's speaking.
Sir, I'll conclude in just 2 minutes, sir. Sir, I read in the newspaper report, sir, today that the leader of the opposition in the Rajya Sabha yesterday gave the Bharatiya Janata Party and the Prime Minister a lecture on morality. If there is anybody who is the least qualified to speak and give us a lecture on morality today, it is the Congress party. The president of the Congress party, as well as his mother, is out on bail. And they give us a lecture on propriety, on financial propriety. And sir, Azad ji quoted the example of Jawaharlal Nehru, that he did not go in support of campaigning of a particular Congress candidate because he had the perception of being corrupt. But sir, I must remind him of history and the historical lessons that the very same Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru had a V.K. Menon of the famed Jeep scam right sitting beside him in his cabinet. This is the history, this is the reality of the Congress party. Sir, the reason why the Congress party does not want a rise of a new India is because in the new India, they cannot make their scams. In the new India, people respect you for your work, for your merit and your talent, not because you have a fancy surname that your great-grandfather had given you. And in a new India, sir, people respect the fact that you work hard. You work 20 hours a day for your people. This is the rise of a new India, which the Congress party cannot digest. Sir, in conclusion, I want to say one thing. Nearly 50% of this house today has first-time MPs. Sir, on behalf of all of them, I request all the seniors who are present here to guide us, to mentor us, and to teach us how we can all become effective parliamentarians. We have come here with a lot of idealism. We all want to approach the old problems with a fresh set of eyes, and we want to contribute our most to the in the service of the Bharat Mata. Sir, lastly, sir, I want to just take 30 seconds to bring to your notice the lamentable, pitiable state in which my state today is, sir. I will be failing in my duty if I don't do that, sir. Sir, while the whole of the country is making tremendous progress, my state, Karnataka, sir, is lagging behind. I promise you, sir, I will not take more than 60 seconds, but kindly permit me, sir. Because the people from there have sent me to speak about their travels and tribulations. Sir, we Karnataka people, we Kannadigas, we have had a great history of political administrators. From the days of Hakka, Bukka, Krishna Deva Raya in the Vijayanagara, from the days of the great Kempegowda of Bengaluru, from the days of the Nalwadi Krishnaraja Vadayars of Mysuru, from my where brother Pratap Simha today represents, to Sir M. Vishveshwaraya, Karnataka had a great many political leaders and administrators who led this state forward, sir. But today, under the most corrupt, most insensitive and most apathetic state government, we are facing backwardness. While the country is progressing, we are lagging behind, sir. Sir.
Niman Binivar.
Sir.
Please conclude.
I will conclude, sir. I will conclude. Sir, just 1 minute more, sir. Sir, I want my state to progress. Yes, sir. I will, sir. Sorry, I will, sir. Sir, I want, sir, Bangalore today is facing the worst of the traffic jams and is the city which is moving in the most slowest pace. From the thousands of crore plus IMA scam, where more than 10,000 FIRs have been registered against the kingpin, to the new scams that are tumbling out of the skeletons, the cupboards of the government every single day, we are witnessing the most corrupt government, sir. So from this place, I want to assure the people of Karnataka. Bandhugale, ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೊಸ ಕನ್ನಡದ ಒಂದು ಹೊಸ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಉದಯ ಆಗುವಂಥದ್ದಿದೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಆಸೆಗಳನ್ನು, ನಮ್ಮ ಅನುಭವಗಳನ್ನು, ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಹೊಸ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಬರುವಂಥ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಕಡೆಗೆ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಹೊಸ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಉದಯ ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಯುವ ಕನ್ನಡಿಗರ ಮೇಲಿದೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಅಶೋರ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದೆಮ್. ಸರ್, ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ಫಾರ್ ಗಿವಿಂಗ್ ಮೀ ದಿಸ್ ಆಪರ್ಚುನಿಟಿ ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಕ್. ಐ ವುಡ್ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಕನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್, ಸರ್. ಒನ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಮಿಲಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮಿಲಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಂಘ್ ಸ್ವಯಂ ಸೇವಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸ್ಪೋಕನ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಪರಂ ವೈಭವಂ ಮೇ ತು ಮೇ ತತ್ವ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಂ ಸಮರ್ಥ ಭವತ್ವ ಆಶಿಷಾತೆ ಭೃಶಂ. ವಿತ್ ದಿಸ್ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಟು ಕನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡ್, ಸರ್. ದಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಅವರ್ ಗೋಲ್. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್.